that. We are in an era when we talk about a knowledge-based economy across the world. And we are in that era in India also. We talk about knowledge, generating technologies. But when we talk of knowledge and technologies, we think of laboratories, research institutions, establishments where formal science research is done, and the knowledge is generated out of that. What we forget is that there is another knowledge system. A knowledge system that exists in communities, in forest dwellers, in farmers, in Adivasis. The knowledge systems that have been generated over centuries and have been held in the custody of the people who work not in laboratories, not in research stations, but in the fields and forests of India and other countries. This is what is called indigenous knowledge. And I'd like you to pay attention to the fact that indigenous knowledge is as valid, as profound, and perhaps in many ways more relevant to our needs as people, to our needs as a community, to our needs as an ecosystem, than just the narrow-focused research knowledge that is generated in formal institutions. That is not to belittle the other kind of knowledge, but it is to raise in your consciousness that knowledge that comes out of other places is as scientific, as valid, and perhaps more relevant to us. This knowledge system is different. And you will often hear, I hear that to my despair in the several committees that I sit on, that this knowledge needs to be validated by the formal knowledge system. And nothing can be stupider than that. No valid knowledge system needs to be validated by another valid knowledge system. So indigenous knowledge as a knowledge base that is the USP of communities and nations like India, like China, like the Philippines, like Malaysia, like African countries, like Latin countries, this is the USP of countries that should be using. Sure. So the knowledge system that exists in countries that have communities of this kind, Adivasi communities, rural communities, this is the knowledge-based economy that we should be building on. Not exclusively, but we forget to build on this knowledge. And this is what I want to talk to you about today. We will look at a few examples, but I think I'll concentrate really on the two essential sectors that touch upon our lives, our food and our health. How does indigenous knowledge play out in these systems? What has it contributed? What does it give us? If you look at food, agriculture, food production, all the food that you and I eat, the many kinds of rices, the many potatoes, the vegetables, the oils, the whatever. Who created this? Because if you walk through the forest, nature, you will not find rice and wheat plants growing there. You will not find cotton, you will not find mustard, you will not find eggplants, you will not find any of the crops that you know out of which you get your food lying around in the forest. So clearly, nature did not create these, and neither did God. I mean, not wanting to offend any religious sensibility, but if you believe in a concept of God, she or he didn't create this either. So who created this? It is the tribal farming communities that lived in forests and fields that created the roughly 300,000 varieties of rice, the many, many thousand kinds of potatoes, the many, many kinds of corn, etc. These were these communities that used science, that used scientific principles of breeding, selection, those of you who are scientists will know what these terms mean, to create out of wild plants that exist in the forest and field, and out of these wild plants, these communities created food. So it was the communities, the Adivasis, the tribals in a country, for example in India, that created those roughly 3 lakh varieties of rice. Do you have any idea how many varieties of rice we developed? We meaning our forefathers or the generations before us. These were not thousands, these were lakhs. One of them is red, the other one is black, some grow in marshy soil, some grow in dry areas, some grow in the mountains, some grow in deserts. And for example, the farmers of Mexico created all those kinds of corn. Corn is not corn. There's yellow, there's white, there's short, there's tall, there's long, there's fat, round kernels, flat kernels. And what about the farmers of the Peruvian highlands in Latin America? Bolivia, Peru. These are the people who developed out of wild poisonous plants. Potatoes. Black potatoes, red potatoes, white potatoes, purple potatoes. Potatoes. Round, fat, long, stubby. So, who did all this? And what were the principles? This was the knowledge system. This is as scientific and breeding as scientists in long white coat, like myself and like others, create when they work in experimental fields in research institutions. This knowledge is as valid, but it's totally crucial to our survival. So where did wheat come from? Where did your bread, roti, chapati, naan, where did that come from? Who created that? Was it found in the forest? No. There were only wild grasses. And out of these wild grasses, the farmers of India created rice. And the farmers of what is now the unfortunate state of Iraq, the area between the Tigris and the Euphrates basin, they created wheat. After scientifically breeding wild grasses, selecting out those, ultimately those varieties that became our food. And even today, faced with global warming and climate change, we are finding a great turbulence. We are looking for new varieties because the old ones are not working. So what do scientists do? Do they sit and meditate in laboratories waiting for insights as to what to do? No, they don't. Take it from me, they don't. What do? They trek. If they want to breed a variety that is going to tolerate the higher temperatures of global warming, and you know that global warming is upon us, they go to the hot areas. In our country, they would go to Rajasthan, they would go to the hot areas, and they would ask the farmers there, what are the varieties of whichever crop they're looking at that survive under your conditions, that doesn't matter how hot it gets, will still give you food? And the farmers tell them, look, don't take that one. That one will not survive more than a certain heat. Take that one. Doesn't give you a very high yield, but it will give you a yield under all circumstances. So what does the scientist do? She or he takes some of that seed, takes it back to the lab, takes it back to the experimental fields, and begins to experiment. So where does the knowledge come from? The knowledge came from the farming community. My organization, Gene Campaign, collects traditional varieties of crops to conserve them for the future so that the scientists of the future have somewhere to go to look for the genetic material that they need to breed new varieties. So what do? Do we go and collect the seeds? No, we don't. We collect the seeds and we collect the knowledge. We ask the farmer, what will this tolerate? What disease does it become susceptible to? But we also ask the farmer's wife, who is an equal repository of knowledge. How long does it take to cook? How long does it stay fresh? How long can you store this? Because all of this has relevance. If you are a company that's trading in commodities, you want to know all this. Your knowledge-based economy wants to know, if I buy this rice, how long can I store it before I have to unload that? If I'm trying to sell a rice as a, let's say, a fast cooking rice, and I'm saying that it will save you your gas bills, it will save you cooking time, I want to know, does this rice take half an hour to cook? Does this rice take 10 minutes to cook? So all of this knowledge that the farming family has is hugely important and relevant to your knowledge-based economy. It's just not just what came out the lab. So that's what's happening, say for example, in the food sector. Take a look at your health sector. Can I have the next slide, please? As I said, food and healthcare, or food and healing. If you look at that data, according to the World Health Organization, even today, in this era of modern medicine and transformative medicine and gene-based healthcare, you still have a huge proportion of people that relies on traditional medicine. Not only for themselves, but also for their animals, for their veterinary care, because please remember, farm families keep animals. Those animals have health issues. Those animals have to survive. Your cow has to survive, your goat has to survive, your donkey has to survive. All the animals that you keep for whatever reason also get sick and also have to survive. So you not only need healthcare, you need veterinary care as well. What comes to your aid? The indigenous systems of healing come to your aid. They're the ones who are able to tell you, if I can ever get this off the ground. So not surprisingly, the market for this, the knowledge-based economy that we've been talking of, the market for this is, take a guess, expected to be something like $5 trillion in the coming years. And take a look at the next slide. Let me take, I've just taken two examples, Malaysia and South Korea, both so-called developed countries in Asia. They are still so dependent on and intelligently using the traditional systems of medicine because they work, and because they work cheaper than allopathic drugs, because they don't come with patents and therefore escalating costs. And surprise, surprise, on last count, and this is an old data, it's about at least I think 10 years old, 7 to 8 years old, that over 300 companies, these are pharmaceutical companies, big drug companies, international drug companies, that have programs of screening the drug development based on traditional systems of medicine. So what happens with this? I mean, when you and I walk through a forest, you go for a picnic, you walk through the forest, and you see these beautiful flowers and a creeper, yellow flowers, blue flowers, and you say, how pretty, we must conserve this diversity and we must conserve this ecosystem, and you say, how pretty these flowers are. When an Adivasi walks through that forest, she or he sees yellow flowers and blue flowers, but sees that these yellow flowers could be a cure for diabetes. The roots of those blue flowers, the creeper with the blue flowers, could be a cure for heart disease. This is the difference between what you and I see. We see biodiversity, the Adivasi sees a bioresource. This is what makes this knowledge system relevant and important for the knowledge economy. So if you look at the knowledge that is involved in healing, healthcare, you will see that the big pharma companies are actually based on traditional medicine without acknowledging it, without giving any recognition. And in this world of patents and intellectual property rights, where everybody's running to own everything, there's not a piece of knowledge that's generated today that will be put into a journal for publication. It will be in the patent attorney's office drafting an application for a patent. That is what's happening in the formal economy. But that's not yet happening, and that shouldn't happen in the economy of traditional knowledge. That should be the knowledge system that was generated by communities in the spirit of give and take, and it should remain that way for the welfare of mankind. But I'll give you an example. Next slide, please. Run through a couple of things about how indigenous knowledge is being used to make blockbuster drugs. go through that. If you see how the indigenous treatment tradition was, which means what was that knowledge base used to treat, and what the patented modern drug or medication is, you will see there's a total direct correlation. Indigenous knowledge, traditional knowledge of healing has simply been lifted and taken to, by the big pharma and made into medication. So Acarus calamus for inflammations, for sedatives, and for mental disorders, echoing completely the traditional use. Iglimamulos, which is bale for diabetes. Azadirachta indica is neem. And you can read yourself, the next one, what it is used for. So these are just some examples. There's several more. If you, any of you who are interested can do this research yourself. Hoodia is something that the San tribes of Africa have used forever. Because when they go on long treks through the desert, they are not sure where they'll get food. And this Hoodia is a plant that they use as a hunger suppressant. Incidentally, there's also a plant that's used by the Kani tribes of Kerala in the Western Ghats, called Trichopus zelanicus botanically, but called Arogya Pacha by them, which is also a hunger suppressant. So when they work in the forest for long periods of time, or they're trekking to collect whatever they need to collect, to ward off hunger, they have a plant called Arogya Pacha, which they use, which has now been discovered, and then all sorts of things were made out of that. Similarly, you go through the list, Rauwolfia serpentina, which is even today one of the blockbuster heart-treating cardiac medications in the world, is derived from, as you see where, from the indigenous knowledge. So if you see the wealth of this knowledge system, which is poo-pooed by a lot of people when you sit in a conference and when you sit in a committee, oh goodness, you know, I mean, who knows, this may be an old wives tale, it may be superstition, you can switch that off. Think back to slides like this, think back to information like this, about how utterly duplicitous that argument is. It's a knowledge system that is used to generate megabucks. Each of these is a huge earner. The pharmaceutical industry doesn't touch anything until they are assured that it is going to be a blockbuster drug. They won't take it into development that far and invest in it until they are guaranteed huge returns on it. And to give you some idea, ethnobotanists have convened every now and then to look at what is happening with medicinal plants and the indigenous knowledge that's associated with it. And we know that roughly 9,000 plant species, 9,000, is what communities know the uses of. So if you collect the number of plants that people know their uses of, they run into some 9,000. Out of these, in treatment, WHO has looked at this data, the World Health Organization, some 7,500, remember these figures, 7,500 plant species, different kinds of plants, medicinal plants, are used in the traditional healing traditions. That's the extent of the diversity of that knowledge, that they know how to use 7,500 plants approx to treat one or the other disease. And to give you an example, the Indian systems of medicine considered to be very sophisticated, Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, these are the systems of medicine that are now finally being acknowledged in India as valid systems of treatment. They use about 2,000. So into even the formal system of traditional healing, out of those 7,500, only 2,000 are being used. You still have a huge number of plants out there that you can tap for healthcare, for veterinary care. And to give you now a comparison with the allopathic system of medicine, the Western allopathic system of medicine uses roughly tops, max, 100 plants. 100 plants to 7,500 plants. That is the complexity, sophistication, diversity of the knowledge of healing that exists in the communities even today. Gene Campaign did and does every now and then a very simple little game. We do that with village children, partly as fun, partly to document knowledge, partly to make them aware of how important their own knowledge systems are. And we do sometimes this little game with kids in the villages. We take kids that don't go to school, because these are kids who are still tending their cattle, they still go to take their goats and their buffaloes and cows out to graze. These are kids who don't go to school. And we play this little game with them about and in restricted areas, right? I mean, they live in a certain village and they know the area around that village. And we play the same game with them. How many plants do you know the names and uses of? So they'll start with wheat and rice and such like, because they're rural children, they know crops. But then they will get into medicinal uses. That when my goat hurts her feet or cuts her leg, this is what I use. It's called this. I use it like this. I make a paste or a boil or whatever. And we have found kids like this can recall some 250 names and uses. Now that is mind-blowing for kids who have exposure of one village and the area around that village, the biodiversity, the field and forest, and they don't stray very far away. So that's the knowledge system that we are not so far acknowledging. China, on the other hand, has acknowledged the knowledge systems. It places a lot of emphasis on traditional healing, and it's included that as part of its primary healthcare system, which is a wise, economically prudent thing to do. It costs a fraction of what allopathic medicine costs, and it's much more easily available. It's available to your local vaidya, it's available to the local healer, it's available to the local shaman. So it's very easily available. There is a huge acceptance about it. And there is, of course, a community knowledge that reinforces that. So you retain that knowledge system and you enable it to continue to pass on to the next generation because it's in use. So what I wanted to say was that when we talk about India moving into the XY century and India becoming a world leader and India becoming part of the knowledge economy, and we're talking about digital India and smart cities. By the way, if you don't talk of smart villages, you can't have a smart city. Loco. Because if you keep neglecting the villages and all that they stand for, including the knowledge that they have, they're just going to come flooding into your cities. So I think that smart city without talking of smart village is a stillborn idea. But to go back to knowledge that is being generated, created, and being demanded, supported, it's not just formal knowledge that is generated in laboratories and research institutions. We in Asia, Africa, and Latin America are sitting on a huge, huge advantage. Our USP is that we have access to that other knowledge system. We have the scientific capacity to generate things out of nanotechnology, and synthetic biology is another question whether we should, but we have that capacity. But this, what we have, which many others don't have, is this knowledge system that is right on top. Food and health, food and drugs, is what we can contribute hugely to and become powerhouses of. And I would urge each one of you who is sitting here to become an ambassador of the concept of indigenous knowledge being a powerhouse of knowledge that our country can use, promote for the upliftment of who? Of those who were neglected, of rural India. So I will end with that and ask you to keep in mind that this is not an ancy-fancy notion. This is science, this is hard science. This is economically relevant technology. After all, you're willing to pay for South Korean technology for chrome steel. Don't you validate it with a heart-saving medication from Ravulfia Serpentina? What's more important? The chrome steel fender on your car? Or the ability to save somebody's life with a drug that you know how to use, that you know how to create and put onto the market? Thank you.